for the first congregational hymn.
Deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, very deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry. From the waters lifted me, now safe am I. Love lifted me, love lifted me, when nothing else could help. Love to him I give, ever to him I'll cling. In his blessed presence live, ever his praises sing. Love so mighty and so true merits my soul's best song. Faithful love and service to him I belong. Love lifted me, love lifted me, when nothing else could help. Love lifted me, love lifted me, love lifted me,
to worship. We thank you, O God, for the gift of this day,
for this beautiful space,
hearts that greet us. We thank you, O God, for the ability to come together to worship,
for songs and prayers that sustain us, not only in this hour, but in the days that unfold.
We thank you, O God, for the blessings in our lives and in our world.
May we lift our voices in thanks, even as we worship you. Let us pray. God, we thank you for this glorious day. We thank you for your love that does lift us up and carry us through whatever chaos the world brings. Because you live within us, we can handle it. God, thank you. You are so good. In your Son's name. Amen. Please be seated. All right, I think we have at least one birthday, and what about anyone else? Birthdays and anniversaries. Oh, is that what you asked? You wanted someone else to? Does anyone else want to come up and pretend it is their birthday? All right, 25, 50, 75, 80. No. Wow. That is amazing. God is good all the time. All right, let's celebrate with you. Ready? Let's do it. God, we come to you with so many thoughts and prayers on our hearts that we could fill more than an hour. God, for our children, for the Sunday school teachers, for the volunteers, for healing, for travel, for so much more. God, we know that you have all of us lifted up in your under your wings of protection. And we say thank you. God, we come together as a church family, a family of faith and strength and unity, praying for each prayer spoken and within our hearts. We come together as a church family, praying the prayer that your Son taught others, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us continue now praising our Lord with our tithes and offerings. I need a couple of ushers, please. Would you stand for our doxology?
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures. Creator's here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
God, we thank you for the blessing of providing all for all of our needs. And then when we return a small portion, God, how you magnify it and turn it into amazing works and deeds and love for your kingdom. So God, please take these gifts that we offer and let us also see the work that you do with it. In your Son's name, amen. Please be seated.
Today's scripture reading comes from Acts 4, 23 through 31. Peter and John were allowed to leave. They went back to their own people. They reported everything the chief priests and elders had said to them. The believers heard this. Then they raised their voices together in prayer to God. Lord and King, they said, you made the heavens, the earth, and the sea. You made everything in them. Long ago you spoke by the Holy Spirit. You spoke through the mouth of our father David, who served you. You said, why are the nations angry? Why do the people make useless plans? The king of the earth rise up. The kings of the earth rise up. The rulers of the earth gather together against the Lord and against his anointed king. In fact, Herod and Pontius Pilate met with the Gentiles in this city. They also met with the people of Israel. All of them made plans against your holy servant Jesus. He is the one you anointed. They did what your power and purpose had already decided should happen. Now, Lord, consider the bad things they say they are going to do. Help us to be very bold when you speak your word. Help us to be very bold when we speak your word. Stretch out your hand to heal. Do signs and wonders through the name of your holy servant, Jesus. After they prayed, the place where they were meeting was shaken. They were all filled with the Holy Spirit. They were bold when they spoke God's word. These are the words of our Lord.
Praise be to God. And thank you for being willing to, there was a lot of scripture there.
Yeah.
Yeah. So church service is going to run a little long, maybe another hour, because there's a lot of scripture to go through. Don't worry about a thing. It'll be fine. I'm going to start with an intro that comes from a small group that I teach. And because it really does, I'm going to start and end the sermon with pieces from it, because it really does a great job of talking about community. So I want you to hear this. Beyond the city limits of San Francisco exists a land of giants, redwood trees so tall that if they were to lay down on a football field, now, this is just one of them, right? Some of them are so tall, if they were to lay down lengthwise on a football field, their feet, the feet of the tree, would hang off the edge another 10 feet. Their trunks, some of them are so wide that a school bus could hide behind it and you would never see it. In the Armstrong Redwoods National State Reserve, there is even a tree that is estimated to have stood tall for more than 1,400 years. While so many are amazed by these ancient trees as they extend skyward toward the heavens, what is even more awe-inspiring is how they have extended underground. It is the root system of these ancient redwood trees that has enabled them to stand strong against threatening winds and violent storms that could rip them from their foundations, some for 1,400 years. Yet their roots do not extend vertically deep into the ground like what we would think. Surprisingly, redwood tree roots typically go no more than 12 feet down. Hardly enough to sustain the 300 feet tall trees or the 300 foot tall trees, some of which have been around for more than 1,000 years. So how is it possible that redwoods have survived in this area, enabling countless people to stand in wonder with eyes toward the heavens to take in the sights of these trees? The answer can be summed up in one word: community. Amazingly, these ancient redwoods have underground roots that extend outwards, so 12 feet down, but then outward about 150 feet, interlocking with the root systems of the other trees, so that they have the stability and strength that is multiplied with the other trees as their foundation becomes larger than their height. They have been able to grow large and strong because they've done it together, interlocked.
That is the picture of what church family should be everywhere. I believe that is the picture of our church family.
And I pray that we do that, I pray that we as a collective church pray that other churches can feel that community as well. Last week, we talked about the importance of individual prayer, and today we are talking about praying together in community. We learn how to pray individually, knowing God better, having a deep and grounded relationship with Him, and then we pray for others. We pray for others to have that same deep, grounded relationship, so then they enter into the community of faith, and then together we bring them in, and we are interlocked, and we pray for even more people, and it just is a circle that keeps going and going. We need each other. We need that community. We need corporate prayer. We need God together, and together, when we need God, together we stand. Now, I want to say for just a second that there might be people that watch online and watch the recorded service later, and I don't think it's a matter of just being in this building. When people watch the recorded service online, sometimes people are watching from miles and miles away. It's not just people that are sick and cannot be here. It's people that watch from miles away. I say they are part of our community. They are part of our church, and we pray for them, and they pray for us. We share in that. And there is something magical that happens. We already know that God is not contained by a space or a time. And when we have people from a long distance away that tune in for church service because for whatever reason they can't get to a church, they don't have a church home, maybe they're in a care facility where they literally cannot get out. We are their community, and they are part of our church, and we pray for them. They are part of all our brothers and sisters in this church. Jesus ascended to heaven. Many believed in Christ during this time of scripture that we're talking about. The Christian church was growing by leaps and by bounds. The apostles were spreading the good news of eternal life. This is what it meant for them. They no longer had to be concerned about if you break a law, you no longer have a relationship or even have the possibility of relationship with God. For the new church in Acts, that when we talk about an Acts church, we talk about the first beginning of a Christian church. And all of a sudden, this was like a revelation for them because they went, oh my gosh, I can be human, I can sin, and I can still have relationship with God because Jesus did that for me. That was this amazing revelation, because even if people were not perfect, the law did not consume them because Jesus did. Peter and John were speaking to many about Jesus. They were not the only ones, but in this passage today, we're talking about Peter and John. They healed a man outside the temple gates. This is leading up to the scripture for today. Then they talked to the crowd about Jesus. They had the audacity and the boldness and the courage to talk to the people right outside the temple gates about who Jesus was. They were preaching, they were teaching, they were turning the crowd toward Christ, and the religious rulers had a serious problem with that, because they had killed this Jesus dude, let him stay dead and buried. We don't need any problems from him. When he died, they thought that was it, the end, we can carry on as normal. Peter and John were arrested for their behavior, for talking about Christ. And the next day they were set free with this strong warning. I want you to hear from Scripture. Peter and John were allowed to leave, and they went back to their own people. They reported everything the chief priest and the elders had said to them. The believers heard this, and then they raised their voices together in prayer to God. Lord and King, they said, you made the heavens, the earth, and the sea. You made everything in them. Long ago, you spoke by the Holy Spirit. You spoke through the mouth of our father David, who served you, and you said, why are the nations angry? Why do the people make useless plans? The kings of the earth rise up. The rulers of the earth gather together against the Lord and against his anointed king. We are the ones that are on earth, but God is the one that knows the chaos of the world. And it was way back then, and he knows everything that is going to happen. Listen, again, there's these pieces here in Scripture. Peter and John were allowed to leave. Why do you think they were allowed to leave? Jesus was captured and killed. And how did that turn out for them? Not so well, because there were still people that are gathering in massive, huge quantities to talk about this new part of being saved. This a matter of, it's not about the law, it's a matter of the heart. And so when John and Peter were arrested, you can just imagine the Sanhedrin, which are 71 people of the highest brain trust in the religious rulers. You can just imagine them going, okay, whose bright idea was it to arrest them? And now what do we do with them? Because we've already tried to kill one of them, crucify, and that didn't work. So if we kill these two, we're going to have the added problem, and it's just going to create more of a problem. So they spent the night thinking about it, and the next day they go, okay, here's what we're going to do. We're going to tell them that they are going to be set free, but they can never, ever, ever do this again. They just have to stop talking about Jesus. Certainly that's going to work. Yeah, here's what Peter and John did. They immediately go back to their own people. They tell their people everything that had just happened. And what do the people do as a community of Christ followers? They pray. They don't stop. They're not praying, okay, God, we're going to stop everything because we're in concern and fear for our lives, and so we're going to stop everything. God, we know you're going to send other people. It'll be okay. No, they pray for continued spreading of the word of God with courage, with boldness, with protection, with the Holy Spirit within. That's what they pray. During this time of Scripture, there is a lot of chaos going on in the world. There's misunderstandings about who Christ was. There's failure to believe or want to believe in Christ. There's the power that is threatened by one true God, the power of not listening to one true King, the power that people want to contain and hold is at threat. Belief in self and self in worldly things creates chaos. We create chaos when we believe that we can do everything ourselves. We don't need God to do things. We can figure it out ourselves, and it'll be much better. Fast forward to however long that takes to figure out the chaos, and it is there. That's why we are in the world that we're in, because too many people don't rely on God, and they rely on their own self-bright ideas. And we have a world of chaos. There was chaos in the New Testament times, similar to our world today. And the fix for the chaos for New Testament times is the fix for the chaos now. Gathering together in prayer. Lifting our concerns for each other, our community, our leaders, our nations, and the world. And when I say lifting up our concerns for our leaders, for our nation, for our world, I don't just mean those that we think we agree with. I mean all. all nations, all leaders, the entire world, everybody in it, lifting people up that they can be Christ followers. That's what we do as a community, locked together like those redwood trees that cannot fall. When we pray for each other and our community, together we stand and together we speak for God. As we come together in prayer, we ask the Holy Spirit to move in all people, those who know God and those that don't. We pray that people come to God in mass quantities. It doesn't matter which Christ-centered church they come to. Just get to a Christ-centered church. We love to fill the seats in this church. Absolutely. But let's fill seats in every Christ-centered church. I wish I could say there was not enough room in every Christian church to go around for the people that wanted to come in. And I wish I could say that I will live long enough to see that. Probably not. Our work is cut out for us, but we pray that seats are filled in every church. Those that know God and those that don't yet. We pray that people come wanting to know Him, wanting to join a faith-filled community, being prayer warriors. We have an amazing prayer chain and we have amazing prayer intercessors. And you don't have to be on that chain or in the intercessors to pray. If you want to be on the prayer chain, let me know. I can work that out for you. And just because you're not part of that chain doesn't mean you're not part of the universal prayer chain. We pray because we are in the army of God. No matter where you are, whether you're right here or you're watching later, this message is for everybody. God brings us all together in prayer. Being part of God's family means that there are no imposed limits because of languages spoken, ethnicity, gender, job status, lack thereof, size of one's family, lack of family, financial stability, or lack thereof. There are no worldly limits. We all are one family. We are all in community, and we all pray for each other. It has nothing to do. Nobody is left out. Worldly standards have no place in our family of God. Together we stand in prayer for God's way to peace rather than the worldly way of chaos. We have a choice. We can be in God's world of peace or we can be in the world of chaos. We can live God's way of peace or the world's way of chaos because it doesn't seem like we can have a foot in each place. We're either with God or we're with the world. We're either in peace or we're in chaos. It doesn't seem that we can have both and. God does not appreciate the competition. Together we stand in prayer for the peace that God brings. Together we become like Peter and John and all Christ followers of the New Testament, spreading the word of God even in the middle of what people want us to do, which is to be silent. We stop saying, I can't do XYZ for God. I can't pray. I can't. I don't know enough. I can't. We stop saying, I can't, and we start saying, I will. Just replacing the I can't with I will is a mindset change because I will do this with God's strength, God's courage, God's help, God's boldness. I will do it. And then we can not only say together we pray, we can say together we speak. We speak the words of truth according to God's word and God's wisdom, the wisdom of the Holy Spirit within us. We don't speak the truth of this world. We speak God's truth. Together we grow and we learn more about God. Together we can be vulnerable and ask questions. That's what small groups are about. When we sit in vulnerability, every single one of us sit in vulnerability. And we talk. There are questions that come up in small group, and I go, gosh, I don't know. Let's try to figure that out. We all are there to learn and to grow and to encourage. Together we encourage each other. Together we learn how to speak as one voice for God. Together we are in community and our roots support each other. So it's not just proximity, it's community linked together. We are the body and Christ is the head. We pray for doing God's will together. We don't pray for doing our will. Let's be very clear. We pray for doing God's will together. We pray for others to see God's love, his strength, the way to do his work. In a world of diversity, God is the only one that can bring us together. In a world of chaos, God's the only one that can make it happen. So we pray for God's plan to bring us together. Whatever his plan is, we pray that we are a part of that plan. We don't have to know God's plan in order to be a part of God's plan. And then we act as one body. Our lives serve as a testimony, as a witness to how God has worked in our lives, to the power of God's word for those around us. That is exactly what Peter, John, and others did. All they did was go around saying, "Have you heard? Let me tell you what I saw. This is what I have witnessed." And many, many people joined the early church. It was a transformation. And I'm sorry, in this world of chaos, we need a transformation. And it starts with us. We may be a small church, but we are a mighty church. And each one of us can show the love of Christ and reflect his will just by living our lives according to what he wants. Then as one body, together we pray, together we speak, and together we glorify one Lord. Listen to scripture again. "Now, Lord, consider the bad things they say they are going to do. Consider the bad things they say they are going to do. Help us to be bold when we speak your word." I'm going to pause here. They know, the disciples, the apostles, the followers of Christ, they know there are bad people out there. They know that people are trying to stop them from spreading the word. They know that there is harm that can come to them and to others. It's a bad world out there. And they still say, "Help us to be very bold when we speak your word." When is the last time you prayed for boldness to speak God's word? I think we miss that sometimes. "God, let me be bold," because when we pray it, then we actually have to do it, which means we open our mouths and talk about God. We go, "I don't want that. God, let me be bold in my prayers." It says, "Stretch out your hand to heal. Do signs and wonders through the name of our holy servant Jesus." Jesus the Christ is the one that does the miracles. He stretches his hands out. What would it be like to be part of those miracles that Jesus is doing? That's a transformation. That's when you have that in your life and you can share it with others. Don't keep that to yourself. And then scripture says, after they prayed, the place where they were meeting was shaken. They were all filled with the Holy Spirit, and they were bold when they spoke God's word. The Holy Spirit is the one that speaks on your behalf. The Holy Spirit is the one that gives you that boldness. Pray for that boldness for the Holy Spirit to work within you. The scriptures, many, many, many scriptures talk about the love of each other, being the love and faith and support for each other, caring for one another, being a community. There are over 100 times in the New Testament where scripture refers to one another. Here's just a few examples. From Mark 9, verse 50, "Be at peace with one another." From John 13, 14, "Wash one another's feet." From Romans 12, 10, "Love one another deeply as brothers and sisters." Romans 13, 8, "Love one another." Are you getting it? From Romans 15, 7, "Accept one another just as Christ also accepted you." Ephesians 5, 19, "Speak to one another in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs." Colossians 3:13, "Forgive one another, even If forgive one another if anyone has a grievance against another. 1 Thessalonians 3:12. May the Lord cause you to increase and overflow with love for one another. And Hebrews 10:24. Let us watch out for one another to provoke love and good works. How about if we provoke love and good works? When we pray for one another and love one another, we glorify God together. We are one body and can do so much. Church, don't let the chaos of the world separate us. Let us link together. So one more time from the redwood tree analogy. In the same way that the redwood tree root system offers us an apt metaphor for community, tree nurseries offer us a vivid picture of proximity. Tree nurseries, like the natural environment for redwoods, are filled with many trees. In tree nurseries, the trees are growing and are healthy from a distance. The trees in a nursery appear to be in community with one another. They are closely situated, and in some cases, the branches are even touching one another. At first glance, you would think they are in community. Yet, when a strong wind rips through the tree nursery, many trees are toppled over, unable to stand like those redwoods we talked about earlier. The difference is that the trees in the nursery have never truly been in community. They only have proximity. Even each tree in a nursery that exists within its own planter box, the trees in the tree nursery grow, but only in isolation. The roots extend, yet they are never able to get the stability that the redwoods have because they are not interconnected or interdependent. True, some trees in the nursery don't topple over, giving the illusion of stability. However, it's usually the trees that are in the middle of the nursery, where the trees are on the fringes of the nursery, have already fallen. Much of what we call community in our church today is simply proximity. Standing next to one another in a worship service, serving alongside one another on a project, even sitting on a couch with the same people week after week does not necessarily mean that community is being cultivated. If you settle for proximity, you rarely get deep community. But if you cultivate community, you will always get proximity. In a minute, we're going to take communion together. And when we do, we absolutely come to the table asking God to forgive us of all that we have done, and to refill us and replenish us. But I want us to do one other thing. I want us to lift each other up in prayer. Let us go even one step further than that. This Thursday, May 5th, is the National Day of Prayer. So who can you send an encouragement to? From the congregation, from someone that is in the building, or it usually is in the building and is not today, or from somebody online that you know watches, who can you talk to give them encouragement? It can be a letter, it can be an email, it can be sent any way you want, by email or by snail mail. It can be a communication of encouragement by text. It can be by phone. It can be by talking to somebody face to face. Any form of communication that you're comfortable with, one of your choosing, but encourage somebody. Encourage them and let them know that you are praying for them on May 5th. Let them know that they are part of the community of God. Together we stand, together, interlocked, strength, strong, for God, and for all that God has for us. Amen. All right, let us come together and prepare our hearts with our communion song.
Faithful One, so unchanging, ageless One.
call out to you.
Again and again.
Jesus Christ, renew your covenant with God. Do you trust in God with all your heart, mind, and strength?
I do.
Will you trust the Holy Spirit to guide your life from this moment forward?
I will.
Will you put Jesus first in your life, trusting nothing else for your salvation?
I will.
Do you reject the bondage of sin, and are you determined to live in the liberty God gives us?
I do.
Are you willing to give an account for the hope which dwells inside you to anyone who asks?
I am, God being my helper.
Are you resolved to serve God that others might know his love?
I am, by God's grace.
Will you strive from this moment to refrain from any attitudes or practices which cheapen the love of God as revealed in Jesus Christ?
I will.
Affirmation of faith. Let us unite in this historic confession of the Christian faith.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Universal Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Amen.
You may not realize it, but you today have shown a great way of community. It started when you came in and you started talking with people, because for some of you, you were praying for those people as you were talking to them. It continued when we had the children up here and we were praying with and for the kids. It continued when we prayed for Bill as a community of faith. It continues when we have our joys and concerns, when there are so many of them, and I know we can't tap into all of them in just the short time that we are together. It continues when you are together listening to the sermon, wondering how God is working in your life so that you can then pray for others and work on reaching others. It continues with our communion. We are a community of faith believers, interlocked together. And interlocked together, we will never fall. Let us continue with communion.
Invitation. Christ our Lord invites us to his table, all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Confession and pardon. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors. And we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. The prayer of consecration. Lord, We do not come to your table, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your many and varied mercies. We are not worthy even to gather up the crumbs under your table. But your nature has never changed. You have always been gracious and merciful. Therefore, enable us to truly participate in this sacrament of your Son, Jesus Christ, that we may walk in newness of life, may grow into his likeness, and may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Amen.
Amen. On the night that Christ was betrayed, he was with his followers, and they were not perfect. Each one of them, you can say, were not perfect. Okay, one really comes out in mind as not being perfect, but they were all not perfect, and he still had that meal with them. He still served them. He still loved them. He took that bread, knowing what was to come, and he lifted it up and did what he always did, prayed and gave thanks to God the Father. God, we do give you thanks for this bread and for the cup. We give you thanks that you are the provider and the sustainer and the protector of all. You are the creator of the universe. You created us with the attributes of you. And God, we pray that we live into that. We pray with boldness that the Holy Spirit breathes in us, builds a fire within that cannot be contained and must be spoken. God, we give you thanks. Amen. And when he was done giving thanks, he broke the bread, and he said, this is my body broken for you and for the many. And then after the meal, he took the cup and he said, this is my blood shed for you and for the many. And every time you eat of this bread and you drink of this cup, you do this in remembrance of me until I come again. That's what this is about today, coming to God's table and remembering all he gave us. If you call him Lord and Savior, you, my brothers and sisters, are welcome to the table. We invite you to the table, and as you recall, we will, if you put your hand out in a cupped form, then I will give you a piece of bread. Just cup your hand, and Teresa is going to give you the blood, the remembrance of the blood of Christ. So, ushers, would you help to just lead row by row? And Shelley's going to play some music. Come to the table of our Lord. Sister, this is Christ's body broken for you. My sweet sister, this is to remember Christ's body that was broken for you. My sister, this is to remember. My sister, Christ's body. Oh, sorry. Broken for you. And his blood should be for you. Thank you.